press. Cilicia was part of the Roman Empire, but because the Roman Empire has shrunk, Cilicia is actually Turkey today, right? And so how does he communicate with people in Rome from far away Turkey, right? That's the question. And so back then, papyrus rolls and letters served as a medium of communication, right? And so we'll talk about why some of these elements are similar. And so there are three fundamental elements of social media. One is literacy, and we'll talk about how to facilitate literacy. Second is interactivity, and it's the ability of receivers to complain or comment or modify the message. And that's one of the unique attributes of social media, right? Compared to traditional media, for example. And the third one, which is the biggest one of the biggest ones, is cost. So if you look at early forms of social media, one of the ways in which early forms didn't take off as much as later forms, such as in the past 10 years, is the cost. So comparing the early social media forms like Acta Diurna in Rome. So Acta Diurna is one of the early newspapers in Rome, and people could comment and like put some scribbles on the newspaper itself. But it's very expensive, right? Because papyrus is very expensive to produce, and also the labor, the mere effort of people having to write down on these scrolls of papyrus paper is very time and effort consuming. Whereas if you want to compare it to the cost of modern social media, for example, Instagram or TikTok, the cost is relatively low, right? Because we've come to the point where one single additional post costs just pennies to the social media provider, for example, TikTok or Instagram. And so this is the last historical slide. So you have Cicero's letters, which I just mentioned. Another social media system was Martin Luther's 95 grievances to the Catholic Church. So they also call it 95 theses, but it's basically 95 complaints or grievances, right? Because back in the 1500s, the Catholic Church was very dominant, and Martin Luther basically had complaints against indulgences from the Catholic Church, right? And so he posted a lot of these 95 theses on the doors of churches and other places where people could see them. And people could comment, and you can see that this is sort of the early beginnings of social media, right? You can post information, and people can write their comments of information. Yeah, I agree with Martin Luther's grievances against the Catholic Church. We should split up as Protestants, separate and away from the Catholic Church. And so eventually that's what happened, right? Eventually those 95 grievances eventually led to the separation of the Protestants from the Catholic Church. And so that's an early example of social media. And lastly, the pamphlets in Oxford coffee houses. There were discussions that took place in coffee houses, and it only spread to other coffee houses if there's traction, right? If people got excited about it. And this is also one similar element to today's social media. If something got traction, then it spread to other social circles. But if it doesn't get traction, then it doesn't get spread. Okay, so conceptually, the differences, maybe I can ask the class, what do you think are some of the differences between traditional media and social media? I guess it's, yes.
Traditional media was less inclusionary. I mean, like, it was one to many versus social media. Everyone could participate in that conversation.
Right. So if you think about marketers, for example, Unilever would have, for example, a brand manager and somebody from the creative side, like Ken Erickson or Sachin.
Oh, great. Make a great question. And that's right here.
Great. Okay. So you can have three people, the brand manager, somebody from Gray, and perhaps another one who actually makes the copy. And then that piece of advertising is going to be broadcast to millions of consumers, for example. And the classical example would be the Super Bowl ad, right? Anyone wants to guess how much it would cost to buy 30 seconds of a Super Bowl ad?
1.5 million.
1.5. Any other guesses? Yes.
I'm pretty sure this year is around
10 million. So somewhere in between your answers, 7 million. 7 million. It's past Super Bowl. So just for 30 seconds. And so that's the traditional media, right? You have brand manager, you have somebody from Gray, and they come up with advertising that reaches 100 million consumers. So social media is a little bit more different, right? One beauty about social media is that if you're a small marketer, you can actually start with a very small budget, and you can tell Facebook, I want to reach people of a certain age in this geography, and then you can get started. You don't need to pay the entrance fee of $7 million to reach the 100 million people. Depending on your skill, you might be able to reach 100 people on social media if word of mouth happens to whatever your material is. And this is what we are going to learn in the next 30 minutes. So these are some of the elements that are different between traditional and social media. First is centralized communication versus decentralized. This is centralized. In other words, if Larry at Grady decides to present a specific kind of advertising, the consumers have no say on what they're going to view on the television screen because it's preset by Larry and Gray and Unilever, for example. And it's just going to be broadcast. However, with social media, because of the interactivity, people can post their comments, people can say dislike, or people can actually complain, report to the fact checkers, for example. There's a lot more interactivity, so it's a lot more decentralized. And so that's actually one of the differences when you think about implications for society. That's why authoritarian rulers, such as, for example, the president of Russia, generally dislikes social media because of the ability of interactivity, right? Like citizens can complain about his messaging. And that's very different from traditional media, where the three people controls all of the message. Okay, so that's those are the three basic ideas. There's modification. So message can get modified by users. There's self-amplification. So what do I mean by self-amplification? Anyone wants to guess? Yes.
I'm assuming, I'm not trying to read the rest of that, putting your best foot forward and amplifying and presenting exactly what you want the consumer to see, like the good, not the bad.
Right. Basically, self-amplifying means that the marketer does not have to pay everyone. If there's word of mouth that spreads, if your message gets traction, it's possible that you only paid for the first 10 people that you contact. But later on, because it snowballs to the 100 million people, you're actually not paying for the 100 million people. You're just paying for the first 10 people. Unlike in traditional media, where if you pay $7 million for a Super Bowl ad, you're paying $7 million to reach those 100 million people. So you're paying for each one of them. With social media, self-amplification means that you're reaching people that you didn't necessarily pay for. And that's the beauty of social media. Okay, so this is what I mentioned. You can reject the message if you're a citizen of Russia and you are against your president invading Ukraine. So that's why the president doesn't like social media because their citizens can do that. And one way if you want to think of this, because this is one way I try to teach students on how to like think fundamentally, you can think of social media spreading as similar to virus spreading. So with virus, with COVID-19, for example, you can infect the first person. And if that virus is very viral or contagious, that virus is eventually going to reach millions of people, right? So if you think about the first case that we had in December 2019, that case started with just one person, and now it spread to millions. And so the way that researchers do in studying social media virality is actually the same mathematics as the way that people who study virus spreading study COVID-19, for example. And there is this concept called R-naught. So if you follow the pandemic, R-naught is basically the coefficient of measuring how contagious the virus is. And we can think of it the same way with social media. So with R-naught.
So you have really good, interesting message that many people would view it 1% of the amplifier. That would be a very high R-naught, right? Because people are really spreading it out, correct?
Right, so the R-naught is significantly higher than one. So in virus, the science literature with virology, if you have an R-naught of more than one, it means that every time you infect one person, that person infects more than one person. So it grows and grows. And so that's what we want to learn, right? If you want to be successful social media marketers, how do we make our R-naught in our social media message go very viral and contagious? Okay, any guesses, like intuition? So if somebody who has not taken Professor Chigurhs's class, how might somebody like that who has not taken classes, what are some of your intuitions? Like, how do you make something go viral?
Controversy.
Yeah, that's one of the slides that we'll have later. Controversy is correct. It says something different on the slides, but we'll see later that it maps very closely to controversy. Any other guesses?
Values.
Like values, yeah.
Values.
Right, values. So we have some a slide later on that is about stories. And so every time you make something fit into a narrative, it makes something go spread faster. Maybe one final guess.
There's the trends.
Trends, okay. Trends, so there's a catch 22, right? Like how do you make something a trend before it becomes a trend, right? So so some of the elements here that I will like show you comes from the scientific literature, and it shows you how to make your material become a trend, as opposed to just borrowing a trend and putting it on your social media. Okay, so there's research done on this, and one of them is Jonah Berger of University of Pennsylvania, and he identified 6 elements that make something go viral. And since he wants his own idea to go viral, he used acronyms, right? So social currency, triggers, emotion, public, practical value, and stories. So he used the first letter of each one of these elements to come up with steps. This might go make it go viral also. So first is social currency. So I underlined letter S to help you remember. And if you look at the scientific literature, what are human beings all about? Human beings are all about prestige and dominance, right? So one element of social media is if you post something that makes you look good, makes you have social currency. So you can think about social currency as similar to financial currency, but that it's something that makes you look good in your social circle, right? because it's bad taste to wave money around, right? So instead of financial currency, people post photographs that have social currency instead, because it's somehow more socially acceptable to post social currency instead of financial currency. And so some of the examples, at least in our generation, would be the handbag or the clothes that we wear or the cars that we drive. And so if you look at Birkin bags, for example, if you post, oh, look at my page, I have the latest Birkin bag or the latest bag from Hermes. That's going to give you social currency, right? Because among your group of friends, you're the first one to be able to know that, hey, Hermes came up with a new bag and you might want to check this out. And even better if you actually own it, right? But even just sharing the information that you are the first to know among your group of friends, that's going to give you social currency and let your friends know that you're very knowledgeable and you're trendy, you're a hipster, right? And so among Gen Z who are carless, travel and food would be two of the most common social currency vehicles, right? So you see a lot of posts on social media about travel, like beautiful views, the Mirror of God. I don't know if you're familiar with the Mirror of God, but there are salt flats in Bolivia that, because it's the salt flat is very reflective, it looks like you're walking on the Mirror of God. So that's why they called it the Mirror of God.
If I can pose a question. So do you think that luxury cars are a big social currency driver for Gen Z? Yes or no?
Yeah.
Why not?
Definitely.
Because some of them, one, don't have cars, and a lot of them are now going on social media, like in our last presentations, where Duncan was like a huge one with Gen Z promoters like Charlie D'Amelio. They only care about like the newest $3 Duncan drink rather than an expensive car.
But I think it depends on what demographic within Gen Z, because there's Gen Z isn't just one giant group, like there's groups within it, and I think that there's a large group within Gen Z that does care about luxury.
Great answer.
A lot of my other solutions that are like prestigious, quote unquote, like luxury cars and less prestigious.
A couple of factors. One, people nowadays in the teens, which ones, they're not driving cars as much as they used to. This is just a look at the demographics. The millennials are not driving, the Gen Zs are not driving cars as much for a lot of reasons. And they don't have the money to buy a Ferrari or a Porsche. And there's other things they could actually talk about that they can afford, right? But that's a good question. And the point about within these segments, well, after our guest is done, we'll talk more about Starbucks, which is your chore this semester. But you've got to make sure that when you're talking about trying to reach the 18 to 24 year olds, you're reaching as many as possible. You can't necessarily afford to go to a small sliver, right? Unless you can afford a multi-dimensional campaign where you go after several slivers. And that's the beauty about social media. You can actually segment things so that you go to different people with different messages, all of which get self-amplified. Thanks, Ken.
Thank you, Larry. And one of the key things also is that if you think about social currency, it's almost like the opposite of financial currency, because people want to post things that make them look good, but they don't want to post things that make them look good and arrogant. And so that's one of the key balance why social currency is very different from financial currency. So I'll show you some examples. So this one is something that a post that went viral before, because it's something that shows social currency. It shows that you're trendy and that you're a hipster. And at the same time, it's not expensive, right? These stocks are not expensive. So on social media, you still look good to your friends. You don't seem like you're bragging or boasting to your friends that you have a Ferrari or a Porsche, because you're only showing a unique kind of pair of socks, right? So that's social currency in contrast to financial currency. So this communicates hipster knowledge, right? If you post this among your group of friends. So this is another example of something that went viral in the past. So there's this very small business called Grace and Lace. And the reason that they became very successful with their small business, despite having a very small budget, is that they posted a picture showing this, the leg warmers. And at the time, these leg warmers were very unique. And everybody who saw the first picture said, wow, this looks really amazing. If I post this among my group of friends, it's gonna make me look cool to my friends. And it did catch fire. Like, it was shared and reposted. And eventually, this small business, Grace and Lace, had a lot of sales asking for people, like, do you actually have this pair of socks on sale? And eventually, they were able to sell a lot of these socks or leg warmers, because there was a lot of self-amplification among the consumers who saw this initial picture and said, oh, I want to repost this because it makes me look good. Make you look good or look up to date, right? You look like you know things. Okay, so one of the person with the most number of followers, Cristiano Ronaldo, so this is dominance based, right? The other element of the dominance, prestige, things that humans are looking for in another human being. The other one is dominance. So if you have a team that is winning, or if you have a player that is very dominant on the field, sort of like the Roman gladiators, right? If you think about 2000 years ago, we have Roman gladiators fighting in the Colosseum. This is our version of Roman gladiators, except without the actual murders inside the stadium. And so you can actually see, right, a lot of the fundamental sort of postures are similar. So even though Cristiano Ronaldo is not a Roman gladiator, like, a lot of the physical postures or manners are very similar to what you would see on the Roman gladiators in the Colosseum. And also, here's the key thing about social media, right? So Portugal citizens or just fans of his team can bask in the glow of the social currency. Whenever his team wins, fans of Portugal or citizens of Portugal would post the winning of that team to bask in the globe, right? And this is like saying, okay, I'm not playing for that team, but because I'm sort of part of that team, it makes people look good and people want to post to bask in the globe of that social currency. And just as an aside, there's a very interesting research showing that when a team loses, then people will say, oh, they lost. They would use different pronouns. They lost, but when a team wins,
we,
it's we. Yeah. People use different pronouns. They either want to bask in the glow of a win or avoid the agony of defeat.
I always laugh when you see people running around and think, we're number one, we're number one. You see that? You're not number one. You didn't do anything. You're your team. What did you do? You watched on TV? You went to the stadium? How are you number one? But people do that.
We didn't score a goal. okay, so what more social currency? Yeah, it is more about the knowledge, right? You know that, for example, Ferrari is coming up with a new hybrid, or you know that Tesla is coming up with a pickup truck later this year. And so people would want to post that to project the impression that they are in the know, they have advanced knowledge. So it's not so much that I own a Ferrari, but it's more like I want to convey to my friends that I'm very knowledgeable. I'm the first to know that Ferrari is releasing a hybrid model. Okay, so we come to the second element of what makes a social media message go viral. T stands for triggers. And so this is like a large company, right? If you work as a social media marketing manager for Nestle, for example, you could have done this, right, on social media. So one of the things that they did that was clever is they linked having a Kit Kat to having a break. And anyone wants to like guess like why this works? Why is this effective?
It's because it's the like correlation between breaking a Kit Kat and having a break, like it's the same kind of thing.
Right. Or every time the person encounters a coffee break, they would think of Kit Kat. Like it's a trigger between the time of day, coffee break, and the product. Yeah, you were going to say something similar or different.
Yeah.
Okay. And so in the scientific literature, there's this concept called spreading activation. And so there are human memory researchers. One of them is Elizabeth Loftus, actually very famous because she was called as a memory expert to a lot of court cases, Loftus is. And her model of spreading activation model of memory is that you can actually compute the probabilities of something triggering something else. So for example, you can think of node one as somebody who has a coffee break at 10:30, for example. So an office worker encountering a coffee break at 10:30, what is the probability that he or she will think of Kit Kat, breaking a Kit Kat and having a break? So if you're able to increase the probability, if you're able to increase it from, let's say, 36% to 76%, then you're going to make your message go much more viral and also lead to more sales for Kit Kat, right? And the reason that they were very successful here is that human beings encounter coffee breaks all the time, right? And so every time that human beings encounter a coffee break, there is a set probability that they will also think about having a break with Kit Kat. So it became very successful because there's the trigger, right? A darker example would be, for example, a drug addict seeing a needle, right? Like if a drug addict enters a vaccine center, a vaccination center for COVID, there's actually a trigger that will arouse the brain of the drug addict to go get a hit of heroin, for example, because that syringe is the node one that produces a trigger that will make the drug addict think of a heroin instead of the vaccination. So this is how triggers work in Colin and Loftus human memory networks model. So this is another example, right? And I'll ask you to come up with other examples if you can. So another trigger would be the 4th of May, right? And why is this a trigger? Any scholars stance here?
Of course,
we'll
be with you. So
right.
May the 4th.
Yeah, so it's a play on the words. May the 4th be with you, or may the 4th be with you. Because those things are very similar. Every time that Star Wars fans encounter May 4th, which reliably happens every year, right? They will also think of this event. And that's why Star Wars will set up an event, a grand event on May 4th, because there's such a strong strong trigger between May 4th and May the Force be with you. Followers. Okay, and this is one of the, not sure if anyone remembers this, maybe when you were younger, a teen. So what Jonah Berger found was that there are Friday spikes because of day of the week trigger here. So you can see that it spikes every Friday oh, what could this be, right? It always spikes on Friday, dies down, spikes on Friday again, dies down, spikes on Friday again. And this was a phenomenon. I guess it doesn't work. That's actually the point, guys. The song is that good. Friday, right? And so the point is the song isn't that good, right? It's not like she has an angelic voice or anything. And the fact that her song still succeeded tells us something about the trigger, the power of the trigger, right? And now I need a trigger back to my slides.
Just face it, Friday sure beats Monday. Right? Yeah.
Okay, and a trigger begets other triggers, right? Because it's social media. So this is one of the things that happens on social media that would not have happened in a traditional media. So guess what happened after Friday, the song, virality? It begot another social virality called Monday, which Larry was just mentioning. And
Monday's fun, I'm sorry. In fact, there's a very famous song by a rock group in the 70s called Monday, Monday. Now it's in the pop, like Monday, Monday, it's really a depressing time.
Click on that top bar.
Oh.
The red X on the very end.
Oh. Just go back to this. So it begot a song called Monday, and which is a parody on Friday. And so this is, oh, you know that song, Monday?
Yeah. Oh, Monday, Monday. I've definitely seen parody of it.
Okay. Song. Yeah.
Can you sing for
us? Monday, Monday.
Yeah, and then instead of driving around in a convertible, like people are holding textbooks of calculus, and, like getting excited about calculus and. Yeah.
Thinking about their advertising promotion.
There you go. Final exam.
So the next element is called emotions. And it's basically when we care, we share. I think somebody mentioned some controversy, right? So one of the ways by which controversy also causes virality is through the mediation, through the mechanism of emotions, because controversy incites anger. And one thing that we learned in the scientific literature is that emotions exist in our brain by design, right? It's helping us take action. So whenever we are angry, we are normally angry about something. And it causes us to take the action of changing something. And if you think about the emotion of fear, we feel the emotion of fear because it helps us escape from predators. So for example, if we are human beings and we encounter a large hippopotamus or a large tiger that we need to run away from, that emotion of fear is going to teach us to take the action of running away from the hippopotamus or the tiger. By the way, hippopotamus are very dangerous. Do you know this?
Right, they're
terrifying. Despite the fact that they're cute.
And they're mean.
They are not cute.
They're like ugly animals.
They can try to be
most dangerous about that. And they're very fast. Very fast.
Yeah, and they're in the water and they pop out and they got these weird teeth. Like, no.
They're actually.
Have you seen a hippo
run? Yes. It's insane.
It looks like a T-Rex.
I had to watch it like my fourth grade, like, I don't know, biology class or something, and I'm like still traumatized from it. I'll never forget it. It's so ingrained in my mind. National Geographic.
Yes.
There's actually a generation of people who think that hippopotamus is quite cute because of the Disney movies. I think people who are Disney fans of a certain generation, they will think that he goes like and actually approach it. Okay, so this is an example of how somebody, a small marketer, so this is an independent filmmaker, a low budget filmmaker, and how they were able to create virality. I hope the mouse works. Oh, okay. Makes this so effective is also that the content is relevant to their product, right? Because it actually gives you a preview of what the movie is about. Unlike a lot of other gimmicks where the thing that drives emotion sometimes is irrelevant to the product itself, right? So I think this is one of the more effective examples of social media marketing. Yeah. And it always goes back to the first slide. So another example is public. Also, there are some believers. P is for public, right? If your social media content is publicly observable, then it's going to gain more traction and become more viral. So some examples here are like Beats headphones. They make it very colorful. And the fact that they are very colorful makes it more likely that people will post about it. And the other example is Christian Louboutin shoes, which have the red sole. So if you think about it, it's actually not very functional, right? Because red soles become visibly dirty over time. But one of the social media functions of having a red sole is that it looks very publicly visible and distinct, and people want to share about it. And that's why a lot of their advertising social media campaigns are very successful.
Did anyone ever see a pair of Merrell shoes? M-E-R-R-E-L-L. No. Ever see someone with custom shoes with like a little red loop or orange loop in the back that has no functional characteristic whatsoever? It's just there to telegraph that's Merrell. Or how about Tory Burch shoes, right? With a little emblem. I know the price of those shoes have come down a lot, but they're still expensive. They used to be a lot more expensive. But the Tory Burch signature had no functionality associated with it at all on top of the shoe, other than it's Tory Burch, something that everybody could see as Tory Burch.
And yeah, another example, and this is kind of more subtle, but if you think about it, right, this is a study in contrast actually of how different marketers deal with this issue or product design. So ASICS and Nike both have technology in their cushioning. So what do you think is the difference between ASICS and Nike? Yes.
Nike made theirs visible.
Yeah, Nike made theirs very visible, so you could see the airbag in the air on the sole. Whereas for ASICS, they have this gel technology, but they didn't choose to make it publicly observable. And the fact that Nike made it more publicly observable tends to make it more viral as well on social media. Because social media is about things that you can see, right? People, at least in the young generation, they can't really read long paragraphs and sentences. Right? They go with like photographs. Yeah, this actually reminds me of this pitch by Evan Spiegel. And Evan Spiegel's pitch is that my idea for Snapchat basically came about because I made the observation that the younger generation don't talk with words and sentences anymore. The young generation talks with pictures or photographs because they're too lazy to type. And so Evan Spiegel made Snapchat, right? He is the founder who made Snapchat, which is basically a messaging platform without messages, right? It's a messaging platform that allows people to talk using photographs. So that's the psychological insight. And then, so this is another study in contrast. If you look at how different brands apply or don't apply the elements in this these slides, Ferrari makes the engine publicly observable or very visible, whereas Lamborghini does not make the engine visible. And so in the first case, it leads to more virality because people want to share, oh, look at the engine of Ferrari, it's V8 or V6 or whatever it is that they want to communicate. But here, it's harder for people to share, right, about the engine, even if they know what the engine is about. Because, well, if I post this, my friends can't see the engine anyway, right? So it makes them more hesitant to post this and more likely to post this. Okay, yeah, this is another publicly visible campaign. Another one. What if you have a product that's not visible? What can you do? Because sometimes you may not have any control over whether your product is visible or not visible. Are there anything you can do about it? Yes.
I'm going to create some type of association with a benefit or, you know, a lifestyle. Because that's like, you know, it's a lip gloss. You know, you're going to look like Angelina Jolie or whatever it is. That's my best guess.
Okay, that's a very good answer. Any other guesses? I think that's correct. I'm trying to imagine. Yeah, I think basically you're using triggers to overcome for this, right? So you're using the letter T, the first element, second element, to overcome for this. Yes?
I'm just kind of going back to the shoe idea. If ASICS had a whole campaign, you know, embellishing that they have these gels in their shoes, and like, oh, you can't see it, but it makes it like 10 times more comfortable to wear. So giving like a, it might not be as flashy, but it's more comfortable. I don't know if that's kind of playing in the same thing as the triggers, but that's just not like that.
Right, yeah, you're a very quick learner. So some ways you can do it is you can.
Have you ever said when your kid limits notions? Make the things that are very visible, tangible, make them intangible. Mm-hmm. Make the things that are intangible,
tangible.
That's what we're talking about.
Right.
That's right. That's a guide to marketers. So they give a service, like a cell phone service, basically, is it the service? But how do you make it tangible? Different phones, different styles and looks, different things to make the service itself appear to be physically tangible. People want to see them. And the reverse is also true.
How much time do we have left?
Yeah, as much time as you want. You're on a roll. So take as much time as you have to be.
Yep.
We can be here until 5 o'clock, right, guys? But take your time.
Okay. So one of the things that marketers did was for Intel, for example, they had a sticker, right? They called it Intel Inside. And for certain brands, they would actually make their mechanisms visible, right? So yeah, Richard Neal, Nadal, the tennis star, wears it. And this is another example, right? So watches, you don't really need to see the mechanism, right, to tell the time. But one way by which marketers promote virality is that if you show the mechanisms, even though they're not essential for telling the time, it makes it more interesting for people to share it on social media. And so there are some watches, for example, they would have special tourbillon mechanisms to sort of compensate for the effects of gravity. And that's something that you can do basically bore a hole in your product so that people can see the inside mechanisms. And the other one is what Nike did with Air Max. So the Air Max is one of their biggest sub-brands, right? It's a gigantic sub-brand that is almost a brand on its own. And the Air Max is really making the airbag visible, right? That's the main signature of an Air Max. And so now you can see from the 1980s to the present, you have the Air Max, which has been consistently successful. And this is like the windowing technique, right? Whether you have a watch as a product or whether you have shoes, you can use windowing to make it more publicly visible and more viral on social media. So here's one more example, publicly observable visually. So depends on, okay, let me talk about this example first. So this is the same product, right? It's the same taste, just more visual. So a donut is a donut, right? But what makes this more viral? Anyone wants to explain or articulate? It's pretty. It's pretty to share on Instagram, for example. And if you taste the donut, I'm pretty sure it tastes the same as any other donut. And because it's got repeated circles, so if you study cognitive psychology, there are certain elements that you can sort of intervene with or modify. And some of these are repeated patterns. So in the literature, there's something called process influency. And it's the idea that if you have, if you design a physical object to have repeating patterns, it somehow feels very comfortable in your mind. I think the Gen Z have a word for this. It feels oddly satisfying.
That's it.
Oddly satisfying. So certain things like this, or things with repeated patterns, like swirling and symmetrical patterns, are oddly satisfying. Like, you don't expect to feel pleasure, but you do feel pleasure. And that's what makes people share it on social media. And okay, so these are, this is just an example of a bread that tastes like any other bread, but because it comes in a unique color. And this is the ube craze that we had, I think 1 or 2 years ago, there was this big ube social media craze.
So I can just tie this back to where we've been, where we're going. Remember, we went from discussing all the roles of research to support your insight, and we talked about Ernest Dichter, the father of consumer motivation, consumer psychology. And when you look at the cues and symbols that Dr. King was talking about, it reminds me of like the Kool-Aid commercials we used to do, where we wanted the mothers to be encouraged to give their kids Kool-Aid, which is basically colored sugar water. It's not the greatest thing in the world. But when you tell mom that we put it by and see what you get. More importantly, how do you telegraph it that kids are going to love mom for it? We've got a little girl kissing her mom on the cheek. Thanks, mom. Now, did that have anything to do with the beverage? No, but did it not sold a lot of Kool-Aid? Because mom saw the little girl kissing mom on the cheek. Thanks, mom. That's cool, but thanks, mom, sells a lot of Kool-Aid.
Oh, this is the mirror of God that I was talking about. So things like this that are very publicly observable and visual. And plus, I added a little bit of element. So this is not part of Jonah Berger's original research, but I added the construct of uncertainty. When you share something that's publicly visible and there's some uncertainty to what it is, it will make it go viral. And this is the added element here. Like, you're looking at this photograph, you're not sure what it is, right? Is this just animation or is this an actual place? And it turns out it is an actual place. Anyone went to this place? So it's
in Bolivia. Not even Nina, you're in Aruba. Don't you go to
not that far yet.
So this is in Bolivia. The nickname is the mirror of God, because it looks like God is looking at a mirror. But the official English name is salt flats. Basically, these are salt flats. And people, once they've been there, even though there's nothing there, they want to share photos.
So Dan, a question. So if people see this material, and there's part of the durable part of it, uncertain, what is it you think the people creating it want to see happen next? What do you think is going on that they do it this way? What's your opinion?
So one of the things, if you're a social media marketer, your first post, if you're a marketer and you want to associate somehow with this kind of image, you don't want to give it away too quickly, right? You want to prolong the uncertainty. So there's this literature from Wilson that says that uncertainty about pleasurable things like travel is something you want to prolong.
And what will happen after people have seen this in theory?
People want to click on it to find out.
Yeah, so let me bring it back to the old traditional media. Because I want to understand the concepts here. This is not just about social media. This is about even the campaigns you create for Starbucks. I'll give you an example. Real life example before social media, we're back. I didn't have any campaign, but it's either Ragu or Progresso. They did a commercial. Actually, it was pasta sauce. They did a commercial where the person's talking about everything, and then the commercial ends before they finish telling you all the ingredients. It's like stop. I mean, went for the 30 seconds, and what happened? People were going around trying to find out what is it? What is this Aunt Millie's sauce all about? They were going to grocery stores. Let me see the jar. What's on the jar? It generated the same idea. So, like, when you come up with your ideas for May 1st for Starbucks, you can say, "Well, don't tell me we're going to do social media. I'm not going to accept that. I'm going to delete it. I get no credit for that. Tell me how you're going to do social media. Tell me what you're going to do for that consistent with your organizing idea that you can develop that would make social media be an extension of it so it all ties together. One thing you can work on is this notion of what I would have said is people want closure. People are looking for closure. But before there's closure, there must be uncertainty, right? So think about how you do that with your campaigns. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. So one of the sort of advice I tell students, so for example, if you want to be a personal brand, or if you want to be the Kylie Jenner of Pace University, then you want your post to go viral. One of the things you should do, or you should not do, is you should not say, oh, these are the salt flats of Bolivia. Because then they already know what the answer is. They don't have to click on it, or they don't have to repost, reshare. So to create virality, you have to prolong the uncertainty. Leave the caption that's more of a teaser, not giving away the answer, like you know, what is this, or this is the mirror of God, right? Like this is a more mysterious way of telling what it is instead of saying that, oh, this is a salt flat in Bolivia. Okay, so Red Bull also does this. The brand.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you, dear.
So that creates some uncertainty, right? Because you don't know if that's real or fake. Is that really a Red Bull can? Or is that really a cake? So it makes people want to click on it and find out. So
make you pay attention. Make you pay attention.
Right. Okay. One more P. So the steps has a double P. It's practical value. People don't want to just look good. They want to be seen as providing practical information. So there are many examples of this. So I guess I should just show one. So there's a small brand called Blendtec. And if you are a small brand, you have to be very creative, right? Because you have a small advertising budget. So they created a Will It Blend viral campaign. Oh, it's unclickable.
Shop Michael's lowest prices of the season. Save store-wide and online now through March 26th.
Will it blend? That is the question. I love my new iPad. It does a ton of cool things, but will it blend? That is the question. Doesn't quite fit in the jar, but I can take care of that.
Oh!
I knew I could get the iPad and the BlendTec Total Blender. I think I'll press the iBlend button.
Beauties of this social media campaign is there are many objects, right? iPad, car keys, maybe Logitech remote clicker. So it actually will get people to try different things to see will it blend. And that's one thing that's unique with social media, right? That you don't see with traditional media. Because with social media, you actually invite your consumers to become co-creators of your advertising campaign. Okay, the final element is stories. So if you look at the literature, there are certain stories that we gravitate towards more. Anyone wants to guess? Because I'm sure you watch movies, right? What are some of the stories that people tend to gravitate to? And what are other stories that people don't gravitate to?
Man against nature.
Man against nature, yeah. Any other guesses? Yes.
Like an underdog story.
Yeah. So yeah, that's exactly what I have on the Budweiser. Yes.
Like a Romeo and Juliet, like forbidden love.
Right, Romeo and Juliet type story. One more.
Like the makeover ones. Like if somebody like they make them like the beginning not attractive, and then they do makeover at the end, so like some like. A beautiful person.
Okay, yeah, this is exactly what I had with Chris Gardner's famous story. So Chris Gardner was an investment banker who used to be homeless. So people naturally gravitate towards that kind of story.
As he was an investment banker, then became homeless. Were you aware of
homeless first, then investment banker. That's true. But I think both would be interesting, right? I think the other way around would be like a Wolf of Wall Street.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not exactly homeless, but was there more hands?
Friendship, like group movies.
Yeah, friendship, and usually some kind of story that. The two people who were initially really close became enemies, and someone who disliked at first, they became very famous. Yeah.
I was going to say coming of age.
Yeah, that's a very common narrative. So what this element shows is that if you are somehow able to fit your brand message into one of these stories, it's going to make it go viral. And I guess I'll just show. Okay. I'll just show one example because this corresponds with one of the stories that
you know look like you from mentioned here.
He found me to all Deutschland.
I want to brew up here.
Welcome to America.
Go back home.
Abandon ship.
Welcome to St. Louis, son.
We have a legend.
Thank you. For this time?
This is the beer we drink.
Off the spoosh.
So, one benefit is that we get to see all of the slides at the same time and realize how much we've learned. Okay, so yeah, that's the end. And thank you so much. And if you have any questions, I'll let you know.
Dr. King, does anyone have any thoughts or questions about what people have heard?
I was curious about the blended ad. So obviously they want people to buy their blender to make their like smoothies or whatnot. Do you think people were deferred away to buy a blender to blend an iPad to see what it could blend? Like getting away from the purpose of an actual blender.
Right. I think that would be probably the minority of consumers, unless like you're super rich and you don't mind like messing up a blender, right?
Especially people put like an old tennis shoe or an old baseball or old stuff they don't need and see if it blends, right?
Right.
Because if you can blend that stuff, it can blend anything, right?
Right.
But then also if the person buys the blender, they don't care what they do with the blender, as long as they purchase it, right?
Yeah, that's awesome.
Yes.
I just wanted to know what your kind of opinion was on, like, specifically companies that utilize TikTok so casually. You know, I'm just like, there's a few off the top of my head that really utilize it as a communication basis. Yes, it's there to promote their brand, but their brand itself has a following. So they use it more for, like, comedy and interaction with younger generations. Is that... What category would you like put that in? Would that be like word of mouth, and shit, the social currency? Would that fall with that following, or social currency, that use of social media so casually, I should say, rather than like very, you know, composed advertising? Yeah, I think part of it is social currency, and also
the brand wants to find out what their consumers are interested about. So for example, if I own a brand and they like to post a lot of dance videos or do paintings, then I suddenly, as a brand, I learned about what they want to do. And then I could customize my messages to tailor to those endeavors, like art or dancing.
I went off like what like, is it proven that like brands or like campaign runs that use like TikTok as like a social media promotion? Is it proven that it does help sales and stuff? Because I feel like TikToks that I see from brands who are copying trends, they seem like TikToks seem like very manufactured and kind of like cringe in a sense because they're trying to do like trends that normal just like young people would do like day to day, just like with their friends, but then recreating it feels like very like manufactured, like kind of thing.
Right. I'm actually doing research on intentionality, and pretty good know about intentionality, which is if you produce something and your audience thinks that there's a lot of intentionality behind it, sometimes it can backfire because they think that the brand is trying to look cool.
It's too staged.
Right. Yeah. As opposed to if it naturally, organically occurs. Yeah.
That's like, for like movies and stuff, young actors or actresses that are part of those movies, they, I don't know if it's like part of their contract or not, but they naturally are making TikToks by themselves, like to promote whatever the product is. And it seems like much more genuine than what they're like in an interview setting, playing like, TikTok.
It's more genuine as you're younger. Yeah. Jimmy Kimmel or Jimmy Fallon. Yeah. I'm not talking about it.
I have a question about, so if you're doing something with social currency and you were like, you were talking about like sharing your knowledge, like if you like repost something and you just want to show your knowledge about like when you were talking about like Tesla, that you know that it's happening, would that be considered dominance or perceived
Which brand is it?
When you're talking about like people posting about they know that Tesla's coming out with like the pickup truck, and they're not like trying to show, oh, I have it, but they're trying to say, oh, I know about it.
Right. It's more of prestige in the sense that you have a high level of knowledge. Not the fact that you own it, but you have knowledge.
And if you owned it, would that be more dominance because it's dominance over the market, or?
So dominance, at least according to the literature, is basically like, for example, teams who are always winning dominant, or if you are associated with someone who's winning, or like a bigger country, for example. So Americans with the United States, right, compared to Belgians with Belgium, because Belgium is smaller, right? So Americans tend to want to post about American-centric social media images to show dominance, because this is a large country, and I want to show my Belgian friends that I'm part of a large country, even if that's like just an unconscious thing that they're doing.
Okay.
And so dominance is a little bit different from prestige in that prestige is more about knowledge, whereas dominance is like sheer size or
power.
Sheer power.
Ronaldo has 558 million followers. The number of followers you have is a form of dominance. The number of active followers you have is even a larger sense of dominance.
Right.
Dr. King, thank you very much.
I appreciate it.
I think we're going to take a break in about a few minutes. I think we're done.
I wanted to
add to the conversation a little bit more. I still got more material I want to talk about probably next week or the following week on social media that I think Dr. King provided us a really terrific sense of the background. But there's a couple things to remember. When you look at social media, probably the first act of social media, who can think of what the very first act of social media was?
What's
that?
They're looking close.
You mean like?
The very first act of someone engaging in social media, what would it be?
Consumer abuse.
I mean, go back thousands of years.
The first
act of social media. Yeah. Was it? We're getting closer. Cool.
Yeah.
Cave. Cave. Possibly reason by the way, possibly images or photos on the side of a cave. That was social media, right? I mean, was it? Because people like to talk to people. People like to talk, or people like to listen. Some people are more talkers than others. Some people are more listening than others. And we're not all the same. Or we differ depending upon if we're talking about movies or sports or travel or food or family relationships, right? Or depending on who we're talking to, who we're speaking with, we're going to spend more or less time on. So I do want to make a few more points, and then we're going to talk a little bit about the schedule for the rest of the semester, which I want to talk about before we break into the break, because I want each team to tell me what they think they'd like to do, and I'll explain that in a moment. About the schedule. Let's talk about the moment. I do want to come pull this up. I want to show it to you, talk it to you. So there's a very famous, you'll sound highly intelligent when you're in a meeting. Part of my goal is to make sure when you're in meetings with employers, colleagues, and you're talking, somehow you know. And I want people that hear you speaking to think of you that way. Okay, that's pretty cool. So, but the point I want to make is so many of the traditional, the traditional forms of media or consumer behavior ideas have simply transformed themselves through social media. I mean, there's a lot of new things in social media, but a lot of the things in social media can be tied back to things that took place way before anyone ever heard of social media. For instance, one of the most famous in the marketing community
if you're getting involved in a new product, you'll understand what I'm talking about. One of the most famous concepts is called the diffusion of innovation. How do you diffuse an idea so that it gets popularized throughout the community? And a lot of the earliest thoughts about diffusion of innovation were, believe it or not, at the turn of the last century. It was, how do we have a way to make farmers more productive so that on a per acre basis, they can grow more crops and feed more hungry people. And that was pretty important 125 years ago, still is today. How do we get those people, the farmers, who haven't heard about this new idea or technique, to pay attention to it and to adopt it? So the diffusion of innovation and adoption became an important thing. I just want to read you the concepts, many of which you heard today from Dr. King. So it's called, what's the relative advantage? What is the relative advantage of what you're offering? Is there an advantage to people? Because when we learn about it, to try it. The next is the compatibility with your existing system. How compatible is it to who you are, where you are, your values? Someone mentioned values earlier. Your values, your lifestyle, your financial resources. How compatible is it to who you are and what you are? Compatibility, right? Complexity or difficulty to learn. If something's too hard to learn, too complicated, forget it. The easier it is to learn and quickly get it, the more likely it's going to be adopted and more likely an idea will be diffused. Same thing with social media. You can't make it too complicated. Say what you want to do, say about Biden or Trump. They do tend to make things simple. If you listen to what they say, politicians try to reduce things to just a few words, slogans that people can remember. It doesn't matter if they're left, right, Republican, Democrat, that's the game, right? And that's how it works in social media. We talked about triability. Can you try something without a great risk? Can you, just like the cars, that's how the automotive industry developed test drives. You can test drive. That Cadillac a few years ago took it to an extreme. They let you take the car home overnight. They had your credit card. They're not stupid. But they take the car home overnight to drive it around for a day. And finally, observability, and Dr. King was talking a little bit about that as well, is what is being talked about observable. So those concepts go back more than 100 years. And what the smart people in social media and some of the scholars have done is they've taken those ideas and modernized them. I talked a little bit about closure, how people seek closure. They want closure. And so if you can find a way to make a social media post that teases people to find out more, but doesn't tell the whole story just right then and there. That's the way to do it, right? All right, I want to talk a little bit about the schedule because it's up to you. I'm going to speak to side teams in this class. We're going to break in a minute. It's now 2:51. We're going to break in a minute for about 25 minutes. I want you to tell me, and I want each team to decide amongst themselves, but I can't have it different for each team. Your decision is going to be, and explain what the pros and cons are. Your decision is going to be, do you need another week to do the presentation that you're supposed to be doing on March 27th? Do you need another week? Understand what I'm going to demand. We'll go with grading criteria again if you want me to, but it's been clear you've had it for a while. I'm expecting to see a lot of different research that basically leads to your insight, in which when I see the insight, it tells me, I should stop the recording for a second. Thank you.